Okay, so as I mentioned, the workflow is a set of or maybe the DAG of actions. Okay, so we saw a start tag, and then you have a tag which is named as word count. Okay, so and it is this action tag is going to consider the information about the MapReduce job which we want to run. If you want to run a MapReduce job, what you need basically when you run the yarn command to run your MapReduce job, and then you provide the jar location, and then you provide a mapper mapper class and reducer class, and then you provide the input on output path, right? So I think I will show that command. So if you look at the yarn command, basically to submit your MapReduce job, so we say yarn and jar and followed by MapReduce job location, and then you provide the driver class and followed by input output. So when you run this command, what happens? So we saw the job will be submitted to the resource manager. Right, so then the resource manager is the one which actually schedules your jobs. Okay, then it will create a application master, it will create a container through your load manager. So then the application master will be running on that container, then the application master will take care of your job. Okay, just to get another containers for running your map and reduce task. So that's how it works. So basically, once you run this command, this CLI, the command line job client, is going to send your job to the resource manager. So that is when you use the command line, it is internally it is doing that. Okay. So when you schedule your job, the same job in Oozie. Okay. So what we need to do is we need to specify your resource manager information. So earlier, actually, we were using Hadoop 1 version. So that time, this component was introduced. That time, there is no resource manager. That time, there is a process called a job tracker, which takes your job and schedule your jobs in terms of map and reduce task. So that time, this component was developed. So they were using still the tag name as job tracker. Yeah, job tracker is nothing but a resource manager host name and port number you need to specify here, and then you need to specify name node, because when the resource manager is getting your job, it gets a input and output location also you pass here, right? Input output location. So input, it has to taken your input from the SDFS, right? So it has to talk to the name node. The resource manager has to check with the name node about the input file information. So you need to specify the name node information also, which is your host name and the port number, which will be 9000 in our case in the Apache Hadoop. The resource manager will be again the local host, and I think 8230 is a default port number, I guess, resource manager. And then you need to specify your mapper class. So you will have a tag for there is, so inside map, so you have an action tag, which I named as word count. Then what type of action is basically map reduce action. So I will have a map reduce tag, so which is going to end here. Within map reduce tag, I have to provide the resource manager information, name node information, other job configurations. So that job configuration, so if you open a MapReduce program, you create a configuration object, right? And you set, you create a job object. One is creating configuration object, and then another one is the job object. In the job object, you set a mapper class, reducer class, right? Similarly, you have to set here in terms of XML tags. So property key is your mapper class, and value is the actual your mapper class name, fully qualified name, which is a package name colon class name. And then you will have a reducer class to be specified. And then what is your input location, your output location? These are the things which needed for OZ scheduler to run your MapReduce job, right? So until you don't provide this information, it cannot run your job. Okay, these are the mandatory fields you need to fill in. So when you the scheduler, so when you submit this configuration to the OZ, so there is a command, again the command line, there's a command line utility where you can go and run OZ command and pass this XML information. Okay, so it will go and when the OZ scheduler looks for the workflow app, it go and checks your start tag, and then start the word count, and then it sees all information and it will run your job. So if your job is successfully completed, it will go to the OK tag, which will be, you can specify the another tag to go. So basically, which is the end. So if it is a failure, then you can actually go and if it's any error, you can actually specify a kill tag. He actually mentioned both end. Actually, generally, if there is a error, then it will go and you will actually define one kill tab. To kill your job, and then specify the error message. Okay. Generally, okay. If it is a success, okay means it's basically success. If it's success, you go to the end tag. If it is failure, you go to the kill tag. Okay. So this is a very simplest workflow which runs the MapReduce job. Okay. You have any question on this? Okay, can I assume you understood? Okay, so what you need to know is basically a workflow is nothing but a collection of actions. Okay, so they actually design in terms of direct acyclic graph. Okay, so it's start from one node and it navigates to the different nodes and it will go and end. So that's how the OZ workflow are defined. Okay, so now we'll coming back to again the notes. So this is the very simplest workflow. Okay, so similarly I can run for IV action. So I'll show you the example for IV action as well. Okay, now we'll come to this. It's all maybe all this. You can run different types of jobs in using a OZ workflow, which are like MapReduce. And if you write a MapReduce job in Python, that also we can run using a streaming utility, right? That streaming utility is also integrated here. You can run that. And PGI, Scoop, and even SDFS commands also can be run. And some commands, it's already represented in terms of tag. You can also use that. And okay, so OZ is a reliable, scalable, reliable, extensible system. And the OZ workflow contains control nodes and action nodes. I mentioned So basically, workflow is a DAG of actions, right? The actions are two types. One is a control flow nodes and our action nodes. Okay, so if you look at this workflow, so basically this is a application tag, and then you see a set of nodes. Okay, so this is a control flow node. This is nothing to there is no job to run by this tag. So what it needs to is just the control has to go from here to somewhere. So these are start node or start tag or kill or end. These are the okay or error. These are control flow nodes, okay, which can control from one place to another place. It will navigate to one place to another place. And there are other types of nodes. These are action nodes, which actually does the job execution. That is one thing. So control flow nodes defines beginning and end of the workflow. So shortened. And there are other control flows like decision and like you can decide, right? Example, example, you run a job and you get output. So based on output, whether you can actually start the next tag. So if you have multiple tags, so or multiple action, based on which condition, you can either go to that action one or action two. So like that, you can build the decision, and we can build the fork and join nodes as well. Those are all control flow nodes. These are the programs like applications we can run. We can parameterize as well. Okay. So basically for our MapReduce job, we need to pass our. For MapReduce, you need to pass the input information. Say example, if you are running a Hive set of Hive script. Okay. So first is to create a Hive table. Then you need to load the Hive into data into the Hive table. So you will be running the load command. Load a particular path. Local path or maybe the in path, and then you specify the table information. So the path for data to be loaded in Hive table can be dynamically, that path also can be derived. So you can use variables to send the path to the Hive workflows. You can use the variables to send a certain piece of information to your workflows. So you can build this kind of workflow as well. So you can start a MapReduce job, and once that MapReduce job is run, then you can actually fork it to run two different jobs. Like, based on this output, there is another Spark job which you can start. Parallelly, you can start a Hive query, and then you can join with that result. You can do other job and stop. So you can build this kind of complex workflow as well. Okay. So if you look at going to the Hive architecture, you are getting right what I'm actually saying. Zar, if you have any other question, please stop me. Are you okay? So you are able to understand, right, what I'm actually saying?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much. Yeah. So we will go to the Hive architecture. There is total three broad categories. So broad categories to you should learn in Apache UZI. One is a workflow, which is a collection of or DAG of actions. Another is a coordinator. Okay, there is another broad category is called coordinator, which is used. So workflow is to just run your jobs in terms of workflow. So if you want to automate it, so if you want to run the workflow in specific interval, every day, night, 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock, then you need to create a coordinator. Coordinator is a kind of way of scheduling the workflows. And there is one more category called bundle, where you can actually just it's a kind of another layer for your set of coordinators. So just grouping. Bundle is more of grouping your set of coordinators into one umbrella, or maybe one under one layer. Okay, so that's bundle. So in bundle, you don't do much things. You just group certain set of coordinators into one bundle, so that you can just start and stop your bundle. But the main things are in workflows and coordinators. These are the things where you will be working when you go to the real-time work. Okay, so before I start coordinator, I will explain you about the how OOSI architecture works. So OOSI is a kind of we told it's a workflow scheduler. So it's a server. Okay, there will be a OOSI server which takes your workflow. Okay, so which you can submit via OOSI client, which is you can the OOSI client can be CLI, or it can be a you can use there is a API that a set of APIs in Java using that OOSI client. Also you can just submit the workflow. So example, most of the case we use OOSI client CLI. So when you submit your workflow or scheduler, so what happens? The scheduler is nothing but a coordinator. Either you run a workflow or coordinator, the workflow goes to the it is submitted to the OOSI server. Okay, so what it does is it takes your workflow or coordinator, and it actually reads your XML file, right? So the server is capable of reading your the OOSI workflow.xml, or you define a coordinator also in terms of XML only. So it can read the XML, and you can actually understand what are the action you defined, right? So it reads everything, and it takes all the metadata, and it actually put it into, there is a one more, so it will there'll be one more component called OOSI database, okay? So it uses, one RDBMS database. So like Hive uses a Metastore as a metadata, storing a metadata information about your table data, right? So Hive can, Hive Metastore can be configured with some RDBMS system like MySQL or Oracle. By default, it uses a Derby. Here also, it uses one database to store the workflow metadata and coordinator metadata by the OOSI server. So that you can by default, it is also Derby when you install OOSI, but you can also configure with MySQL or other RDBMS system. So all your workflow and scheduler coordinator information is stored on the database. So based on that information, it actually goes and takes the action. If your action is a Hive action, then it submits your job to the Hive client. So there will be a OOSI launcher. Okay, so that OOSI launcher sends the action based on the action. So if it is a Hive action, it go and sends your Hive queries to the Hive client, which runs MapReduce jobs. Okay, so if it is a MapReduce action, the job client, it will actually, the launcher will send your information to the job client, which is the Yarn client, and which in turn submits the job to the resource manager, and it will run. So anything you send, whatever workflow you submit, it will just go and refer the action, and it actually, the OOSI server submit your the OOSI action to the cluster, the Hadoop cluster, to run the respective jobs. So that's how the OOSI architecture is designed. So there's a OOSI DB, which I missed out here. And so coming to OOSI coordinator, OOSI coordinator jobs are recurrent OOSI workflows triggered by time or data availability. Okay, so coordinate is the thing, but scheduling your workflow. Okay, so you can schedule based on the time. Okay, you can actually tell that, okay, on this date and on particular time I want to start this workflow, and it has to run for every day at whatever the interval you specify. Okay, that is scheduling your workflows in a coordinator in terms of time frequency. Okay, so anyway, start date will be there, and the frequency you can specify in terms of time. Okay, that is one type of coordinators. There is another type of coordinator. There will be a start date. Again, there will be a start date, but that the recurring interval can be specified based on the workflows can be triggered based on the data availability. One is time based triggering, another is the data based triggering. Okay, so that is available in the Woozi coordinator. And I said Woozi bundle is the like another high level abstraction which will have the batch of coordinators. See, the in coordinators you can schedule only one workflow. Okay, so the workflow can be of multiple sub workflow. So that in another information to provide, workflow can have sub workflows. Okay, so if you look at this, what you see is basically one workflow app which contains a set of actions, right? So this action is to run your MapReduce jobs. There can be another action which can run Hive job. There is another action which can run the scoop command. Similarly, there can be one action which can trigger another workflow. So that is called sub workflow. So a workflow can run another workflow is called sub workflow. So that is another feature in workflow. But in coordinator, you can run only one coordinator. Okay, so sorry, one workflow. So coordinator can be scheduled to run only one workflow. But internally, that workflow can have sub workflows. Bundle, you can actually put multiple coordinators in a single bundle. Okay, and you can start and stop and suspend the things by using this bundle. Okay, so it's just a kind of organizing your coordinator set of related coordinators into one bundle, and you can just do it. But mostly we'll use coordinators and workflows. We sometimes people may use bundle, or they sometimes they don't use bundle. Okay, so this is okay. So workflow is okay. So this example is to have a Hive script, and you want to run that Hive script in a workflow, and then schedule that workflow in a Woozi coordinator. So if you want to run your, if you want to schedule your Hive script, so basically you need to create a script. Okay, so what script I have? So I have one script. It's kind of creating a table. It's a customer table. So I'll just put the script in a create table dot SQL. So this will have. I'm creating one more script, which will have load command. Okay, so which I am actually going to pass this input path dynamically. I am not hard coding the input path, so I can use a variable called input path. So how do you access the variable? This variable will be defined in the configuration file, and from there you can actually bring it. So you access your variables, so you need to use this way. You have to put a dollar the curly braces, open close curly braces, and variable, and this has to be placed under a single quote. So there are two script, create script and load script. And now we want to schedule this script in a Uzi workflow. Means you have to run this script via Uzi workflow and schedule it via Uzi coordinator. So I told you there is a file called workflow.xml where you define your workflow. And there is a one more file called job.properties. Okay, so if this one, this file name can be a workflow.xml simply, or you can also different name also you can keep, like, but it can be, it should be a dot extension of XML. And if you are not providing a workflow.xml name, instead there you just give mr-workflow.xml. When you submit a Uzi command, you just have to specify the file name. That's it. And I told you there's one more file called job.properties, where you specify whatever the variables you use it in this workflow, you will be specifying in the property file. Okay. So this is the property file you specify while running a Uzi command. Okay. The Uzi submit command. So what this is, simply a key value pair file, you know, right? So people who have seen the property file, so basically it will have a key and a respective value. So my key is I'm just kind of defining your variables, creating a variables and assigning values, similar, something like that. So key is basically a name node, and my value will be the name node URL. Okay, so basically the host name is this one and the port number is 8020. So I was using the Cloudera distribution of Hadoop. So there the name node is configured at 8020. And then another property is the job director or the resource manager. I think this name we can change it also. So here you need to specify the resource manager host name and port number. The default port number is the 8032. Okay. And there's a queue name by default. You can use default. And you have to specify the, basically I'm defining my root folder. Under that, I'm going to place my workflow folder. So it's just organizing your XML file in a certain path. So for that, I'm just using my root path is a Uzi example. And then you need to configure these properties. One property is to configure system.lib path. I'll come to this later. You need to enable that into true. And then this is very important, okay? Enabling specifying the system lib path. So see, so what actually this Uzi does, basically whatever so please use the same link to join whenever this closes up. Okay, now when you submit a workflow and you are specifying different actions, and based on the action the Uzi server is running your particular action on cluster. So how does the Uzi server able to talk to the different components and run your jobs, right? So it needs the libraries of the different components. Say example, if you want to run your Hive script to the Hive client, so you need a Hive related jars. And if you want to run a MapReduce job, then it has to talk to the job client, okay, that yarn job client. So it needs jars or libraries related to yarn. So if you want to run a Spark job, then you need a jar related to Spark. So any job, if you want to run by the Uzi server, it needs those related jars. The respective components related jars. All the jars are kept in your SDFS, okay? So that path is nothing but a share Uzi user share lib slash, there's a one more level subdirectory, Under this, all the jars will be kept. So people generally quote it as what is a shared lib path location. So a shared lib will have the all the components jars, so that the OSI server can make use of those jar to submit a job to the respective component. So that we need to specify. And then this is one more important. So this is the property where you can specify your workflow path. So you need to define your workflow and place it in the respective one, any location you can specify. And that location you have to specify to this property, so that OSI workflow go on. It has to read your workflow.xml, right? So workflow.xml will be available on this path. So it will be in HDFS. So you have to place this workflow.xml in HDFS. So where you can specify, so the name node, the it is taken from the above which you declared, and then generally you'll have user folder and the username, and this is just organizing. I'm just having one folder name OSI example. Under that I'm creating a OSI example underscore WF workflow folder, and I'm going to place my workflow.xml under this directory. And then I'm declaring one input path. Okay, so on this location I'm going to write my input data, and this will be taken by the this I'm going to use it in the this path. I'm going to use it in the I'm already using it in what is that here in my Ive script. Okay, so that is a path I'm defining as a variable. Then I have to define a workflow. So if I'm defining a workflow, I told you the first tag is a workflow app path. Workflow app tag. So app tag, and I'm just sending some namespace information and the name of the workflow. I can specify using the name property. Okay. Then there is a start tag, and I have to say which node I have to start. And coming to this, okay. So there is an action which name says Ive create table node. Okay, then now I have a action Ive tag. So basically I'm going to run a Ive job. So I told you, in this example, you'll have a set of action top, the action which runs different types of jobs. Here MapReduce job, here I'm going to run a Ive script. So you will have a Ive tag here. For Ive also, you need a job tracker, which is a resource manager, and name node information. And then you need to have a this file. Okay, so basically whenever you submit your Ive query, you should also place your Ive-side.xml, actually which has information about your Ive service. Okay, and then inside Ive, so the Ive job XML, then you need to specify your MapReduce queue and followed by the script tag. Okay, so inside Ive you need to specify all this information. So Ive tag, inside Ive tag you have a job tracker, name node, and job XML, and which will have a script tag. Here you have to specify your Ive script which it has to run. Okay, so all this information, all this script and Ive cited XML are kept it in your directory. And once this is ran successfully, then you are going to start another action. So that you are specifying, what is my next action is insert the data into the Ive table which you created. So it comes to the next. So suppose if it is failing, then it has to go to the fail tag, fail action or fail node basically. Okay, this is insert. See, again insert also is going to have all the information to be captured, and I have a script to run. So I have insert script, and this is parameterized script. I need to pass this parameter, the input path equal to dollar input path. This variable is which is defined in the workflow job dot properties, and here I'm creating a variable name as input path, which I'm already using it in the Hive script in this name. And then again you will have if it is success, it is going to the end tag. If it is fail, it goes to the fail tag. Just a minute, I'm just getting one call. All right, so once this script is run successfully, it will goes to end, or you can actually go to the failed node. Okay, then the workflow completes. Now okay, once this is defined, okay, so how do you submit your Oozy workflow, okay, so to your Oozy server, okay? So using a command, okay, what is the command? Oozy job, and you have to specify the Oozy URL, okay? So Oozy as URL, okay, so which will be running on the port number 11000, okay? Oozy job, and you have to specify property called or option called hyphen Oozy and Oozy URL and hyphen conf. Specify the your job.properties file with the location where it is located, and then the hyphen run. So it is going to submit, or the Oozy client will submit this workflow to the Oozy server to run your workflow. Okay, and okay, so basically so this is the command to run your Oozy workflow. Okay, and in this example what I am doing is I'll just the remaining part I'll come later. Basically, this is a way you can actually run your workflow to the Oozy. Okay, then I have to schedule. So if you want to run one time, I can use this command to run and I can test my workflow. So the workflow will run for only one times. So it will create a table, and then it creates the Hive table, and then it loads the data into the Hive table. So that's what this workflow is going to run. So if you have a different workflows which you need to run periodically, okay, so create table can be once, that is but insert we may load the data based on the new data which is coming, right? So if it is a table which is going to capture data for every whatever data comes in every 1 hour, if you want to load into Hive table, so you can schedule your workflow in a coordinator to run every 1 hour. Okay, that you can do it using a coordinator, which I'm going to explain now. Okay, so we have only 1 minute left. We'll just close this session, and please join the same link. We'll start the Oozy coordinator in that.